I'll just start out by saying I could just leave it at this probably, but it was good to win. And then we had to watch the film. But it was a mixed bag for sure about our play. And I guess the best way to say it from there is that we needed all the parts by the time it was over. I think overall our defense really had a nice day. This was a team and an offense that we had a lot of respect for going in, very productive, and it wasn't just this year. They've been building that up over time, and we held them to about 120 yards, less than their average, and we made some plays. We did give up two explosive plays, but overall, I think we played soundly. We made a lot of nice open field tackles that were tough plays that saved us, really. We had two interceptions. The one for points was big, and we had three sacks. We did have five penalties, two offside, a pass interference, a defensive holding, and a substitution penalty. Guys that played well, Josh Banderas really had a nice day, had 11 tackles. Dedrick Young continues to play well. Michael Rose Ivy had some nice plays. I think Chris Jones and Kalu are really giving a solid play. Chris had a good coverage day. Kalu did for the most part, and he also made some great tackles. He made some big-time plays coming off of blocks that really saved us, particularly when that second quarterback went in and was running. Josh made some big plays. Kevin Maurice continues to play very, very well. He was a big factor. Carlos Davis probably had his best game. And our two of our safeties, Nate Gary and Aaron Williams. Nate had a lot of plays. So, you know, I think Nate's awareness came into play. That one time they set up a screen and I thought, boy, this looks bad. And all of a sudden Nate slices through there and makes a tackle for no gain. I thought that was a huge play. And Aaron Williams is just a playmaker. You know, he's got a great nose for the ball, makes plays. I really like how he's playing. Offensively, you all know what that looked like. It was not a good day. The production was down. We had two turnovers, not much in explosive plays. It was a rough, hard day. We had four penalties. And at the same time, when we absolutely had to do something, we had a 14-play drive that took up time, and we ended up getting points on it that won the game. I thought Newby was a bright spot offensively. I thought, again, he was really a man there at the end, made some good, tough runs. Nick Gates, I don't know if you guys noticed that. He was hurt almost the whole game, bad, bad ankle, stayed in there and played like a real warrior. Sam Cotton filled in well, had a good game. Cole Conrad again stepped in, so we're proud of him for how he did that. It's just that time of year, you know, you got to have some guys step up and do it, and you expect them to do. Special teams, again, it was like I've already described the game. It was some really, really good stuff and some bad stuff. And our kickoff coverage was excellent. Josh Banderas went on the kickoff team and made tackle on our opening kickoff of the day. Luke McNitt made a big-time tackle, great play. JoJo Doman probably had his best day in coverage. And Drew is a key to that, you know, placement, hang time, depth of kick, all those things together. Drew Brown is really having a good year. I wish I wouldn't have tried that long field goal in that Illinois game. Otherwise, he'd be perfect. You know, I mean, it was that they should take that off the books and put bad coaching in there or something. And our kickoff return, you know, I'd say it was average at best. Our punt return, we just need to give DeMornay a little more room. We were in situations a lot there in that midfield range where, you know, knowing this team's background, I was really suspecting a fake. So we left our defense on the field for, I think, three punts. And, you know, you don't often get great returns when you leave your defense. And we work on that, but you just don't. And the field position part of it's hard to get returns. But when we give him a little space, he had another nice return, and with a little more awareness on that play, we'd have scored. You know, their punter actually made a heck of a tackle on that and came out of nowhere. But if we'd have just had some awareness with one guy, we could have blocked him and been off and gone, I think. And then our field goal team, you know, we're filling in some guys in there, and it didn't look great all the time, the protection part of it, extra points and field goals. But we've got to shore that up a little bit. Our field goal extra point block is okay. You know, we haven't made anything happen there yet, but we're pretty sound. And then our punt team, you know, it was a bad day. You know, we couldn't protect. We get a punt blocked. Thank goodness it ended up being a safety. If it had been a touchdown, we'd have lost the game. And then we give up a big return. So, you know, that team's job is to protect and cover, and we didn't do either of them. So we got a lot of work to do there. Overall, it was good to win. Our kids played hard. I really, really respect and like this team's ability to just continue to play regardless of circumstance. And, you know, when you win on the road, we just take it and go home. So I was proud of that. And then what we have to do is look at it hard and fix the issues that we have, and then get ready to play Purdue. Now, Purdue is offensively, they're one of our conference leaders. They lead the league in passing. I think they're fourth overall offensively. They moved the ball up and down the field against us a year ago, ran a ton of bootlegs against us, misdirection plays that hurt us, quarterback hurt us last year, throwing and running the ball himself. They have a kind of a running back by committee that they do a good job, and they have a wide receiver, Yancey, that appears to be their number one target. Defensively, they're a 4-3, cover 8. We see a lot of that in our league. They'll put their own little characteristics on what they do defensively, and then they play a lot of man-free defense. 54 and 95 defensive linemen are good players for them. And number 21, the linebacker, is their leading tackler. So, you know, we've got to kind of start over with getting ready for that game tomorrow with our team. Today's our team's day off, and so we'll hopefully take advantage of that, and then we'll start getting prepared for Purdue tomorrow. We can open it up to questions.
Mike, you guys are 6-0. With people starting to scrutinize what 6-0 looks like for Nebraska, I guess could you kind of weigh in on how you weigh style play versus just winning in the playoff era?
Well, I think that, you know, first of all, it's just like I told the team and what I've always believed about football. Whether you start off good in a season or you start off bad in a season, you're usually, you know, your identity is basically the story is told by how you finish. And so we're at a good point with our record right now. We love that record, you know, and whatever ranking that brings us right now is great. But we all know that you're looking for it, you know, you'll be identified by your season in total. So all this stuff right now is just fun for everybody else. And for us, it's exactly the record that we want. And now we have to get better. And that goes, whatever our record was, that would be the story I would be telling you anyway. So we appreciate that. We like the identity of this team at this point on how they play and play to win games, and have made plays to win games. But we also understand that, you know, we watch the film, and then we've got to help them get better, and they've got to have the willingness to be better. They got to stay coachable. They got to stay in the moment. It can get harder. You know, it can be hard when you're distracted by the noise that's out there when you're losing. It can be hard and be distracting when you start to believe how good you are and don't really work at it anymore. So whatever the situation is, you can't be distracted. You got to get better. You got to have a hunger to get better. You've got to be realistic about what you have to get better at, and then you just go from there. So you know, and saying all that, you know, it's just part of the storyline. And I've said already, I don't really care. I like the record. I know what we have to get better at. So we're going to work at that and try to win our next game. And then we'll like that too.
What's the offensive line situation this week? I know Whitaker and Cole Conrad have been kind of moved up with your group. I mean, is there another guy that moves up now with kind of the situation you guys have right now at this point?
Well, you called it with the two next guys that would be available. You know, we've got, you know, it's kind of that part of the season where you really now have expectations of the next guy up and to understand that we'll feel fine about that. We don't like losing guys due to injury, but we have to be ready. So, you know, the moves yet we're going to still talk about today, you know, because Neville was out right away. Nick Gates has been hurt. And, you know, so who's going to be if Nick can't play and Neville both can't play, our two tackles, then we've got to probably make a move with somebody that has been very versatile. A guy like Sam Hahn could possibly be a tackle. Corey could go into guard. You know, and then Cole and Sam would be our tackles that way. So, you know, we're going to mess around with talking about that kind of thing. We'll find out more about Nick and David, you know, before tomorrow's practice. So, and then there's that group behind them like Jalen Barnett that's in that mix. We'd rather not at this point pull a red shirt, you know, on a guy. But we'll have to look at it all, what's best for this team for the moment and be careful about what we might do in that regard.
We've had seven freshmen, so three redshirt freshmen, Jackson, Barnett, Hayward, and four true freshmen. None of those seven played a snap, really, or a snap.
Right.
A snap.
Yeah.
What do you attribute that to, and how concerned are you that maybe those guys weren't ready, and you guys are kind of relying on, I mean, you're fortunate to have the walk-ons here, but you're relying on guys that you maybe hadn't thought you'd rely on.
Well, that's part of the development of people, right? I mean, and so, you know, wherever these guys were when they came in, a guy like Sam Hahn, whatever Sam had walked on, when we looked at it at the beginning, when Gerald got hurt, Sam was the best guy to go in there and play. So we do it like that. Now, we still have great hopes for guys like Decker and Christian Gaylor and Barnett and but frankly, those guys were not ahead of Sam Hahn when we made that decision initially. I think that those guys that you mentioned are going to be good players. The development of people is different. And that line position, that's probably the position overall in my career that we've had the fewest true freshmen or even redshirt freshmen just break in and all of a sudden be a starter. Now, we find that guy once in a while, but the development there, both mentally and physically, sometimes takes a little longer. But we expect those guys to be front and center in the competition as we go. And the fact that they haven't played yet, like we made the comment about Christian Gaylord yesterday, that he has come on. And we have worked these guys more in this season, like during Sundays and during some extra work, than we ever have before. They scrimmage every Sunday, and they get to play some football, and I've just seen that get better and better as we've gone along. So we're trying in every way to keep developing these guys that have talent and get them ready to play, and maybe one of them will surface. As we talk, maybe one of those guys will say, well, this guy's got to be that guy to fill in right now. But whatever it is, I think we're going to be fine.
Coach, what is Tommy Armstrong's overall health right now, and what are some of your thoughts about today?
Well, Tommy is like a lot of guys this stage of the year. He missed the bye week of work, and so he had the regular week of preparation. But as the week went on, I thought that this guy is healthy and feels good and looked good in practice, was running, throwing, all that. So I think that, you know, he is like a lot of guys are today after a game. He's sore and he's got some ice on and all that, but we fully expect him to be ready to go and play.
Mike, you ran the ball 14 straight on that drive. What do you think you could get done before that, and why have you guys been able to do that, closing out a couple games?
You know, I wish I had I could just give you the answer to that. I can give you some thoughts that I have about all that. I think that one of them is the mentality of our team. I think that you know, they have tended to play their best ball at that time when exactly when we need it. We've had two games in a row, two drives like that in the fourth quarter that were big. And so I think the ability to pull it together, and it's as much mental as it is physical. And then the physical part besides that might be that we're in good shape. You know, this team has not faltered in the fourth quarter looking tired. I think that we have actually worn some teams out and played better than them in the fourth quarter. Is that because of the mentality of the team? Is that because how good a shape they're in? I'm not sure, but something's there like that that I appreciate. And and the other thing, we pull it together and find some stuff too that I think our coaches, you know, sometimes you wonder why it takes so long, but we find some stuff that looks like the best stuff to do.
Terrell's not a 220-pound guy who's been on for three quarters. Why has he been effective?
I think a lot of that about Terrell Newby, he's a good football player, he's a versatile football player, and he's a tough-minded guy. And I really like him. He's been a man in the fourth quarter the last couple of ball games, and I really appreciate that.
Mike, how close are Seth and Jordan, you think, to getting back? And also, going back to Gates and Neville, are those both ankle injuries?
Ankles,
yeah. Would you label them as questionable, or what's their, I guess, status?
I'd say right now you'd have to say questionable. And, you know, I hate to go too far into the week without an offensive lineman practicing. So there's just so much stuff, you know, the different pressures, the pickups, all that. It's hard. So we need to know as soon as possible, but I don't know what that means.
Mike, the Purdue coach was fired up yesterday. Yeah. Your thoughts on Darryl, and how does that impact the team midseason, you think, going into plan?
Our team, or I don't know. You know, we're always sorry to hear that. I did not get a chance to know Darryl very well, but I had a sense that their team was improving, and that's what I'd just seen from afar without even having studied them too much to this point until now. You know, but anyway, as far as we're concerned in this world, we just go on and play, and they will deal with what they have to deal with going forward. But I know that's a difficult situation.
And Mike, you've kind of outlined the areas of concern on special teams. Offensively, I guess, what are the most critical things that you guys need to brush up?
Oh, boy. I think our inconsistency was the biggest factor the other day. You know, really what we can rely on the other day, drive to drive, wasn't very good for most of the game. You know, we made some plays early. Looked like we had a chance for a decent start. We misread some stuff, however, that we left out there, you know, and you just hate that, because it kind of shows itself as the game goes on. When you leave a chance to make a play, you know, we had a couple fly sweeps that I thought we could score on, and, you know, we just didn't execute as well as we need to. And so I went back and we talked with our coaching staff this morning about the blocking of that play, the running pattern of that play, and, you know, why we failed on it, because we got to get that information to. We can't give up points like that or chances for, we had two, maybe we don't score, but we had chances for a couple of explosive plays there, and they turned into 5-yard gains. So we're missing some stuff, but I think our consistency factor is what bothers me most. You know, you just being able to put on, you know, play after play. Now, I say that, and at the same time, you know, we did it in the fourth quarter to basically ice and win the game, which I appreciate. I just think that, you know, we would like to be more consistent throughout the game.
On those sweeps, was it blocking or was it?
Yeah, both. It was both. I thought the running pattern wasn't great, and the patience on the running wasn't great, and the blocking wasn't great.
Mike, you guys are 9-1 since that Purdue loss last year. What made that game kind of a turning point game? It was such a low point that day to lose at Purdue, and then since then you guys obviously have gone on a nice run.
Well, it's hard to put your fingers around all of what that might mean. I think that the one thing for sure that I appreciate is that despite those circumstances a year ago with this game, everybody, the players kind of stayed with it and kept playing and working hard, and the coaches kept going, and you know, that there might be a lot of other stuff that, you know, might sound like I'm making up, but maybe we found a better way to coach this team offensively, what to really approach and how to do it. And maybe we just got better and we just built on that. And then I think that whatever that was the last month carried over for sure in the attitude and work ethic. And then I think the leadership of this team within the playing group is very good. The intentions, I've already said this many times, the intentions of this team are great. And they work hard and they want to win and they want information. And the coaches, I think, continue to work and stay the course. So those are key factors in hard times. And then they're also key right now. We got to just stay the course, find a way to get better, win the next game, and then go from there.
Mike, how have you fostered sort of the leadership structure of the team this year compared to last year? Did you learn anything last year, you know, that sort of changed the way that you, again, sort of developed that group of leaders?
Well, I think, you know, overall this group of kids in general and some of the older people in it are pretty mature, Dirk. You know, so they're really good people just to talk to. And I think that there's nothing like personal interaction with people. You know, and that's why I always encourage coaches, every part of our staff, to talk to these guys. A very simple thing, and that's how I say it. Talk to these guys. Find out how they're doing. We have so many guys, and we have no idea really what's going on a lot of times with them personally. And so the only way is to deal with that is communication. And I can't talk to 140 guys myself all the time. So this needs to be a staff thing. And that's why we have enough guys to do that. So I think that that's a big deal. But I think that this group is mature. They are verbalize what they want, I think, really well. So part of the time for us is just to listen and see what's going on. And then, you know, with people like we have right now, you can just tell the intentions are really good and they want to do well. And that's a fun group to coach.
Have you had an experience in your career going against a team in a mid-season coaching transition? And does that make it difficult on you in any way, not knowing exactly what the new guy in charge is going to do?
Well, when you coach in the Canadian League, it's kind of a way of life up there, it seems like, sometimes. So it's not, that part of it's not brand new, but there is some mystery to it. You don't know, you know, if indeed there might be some new wrinkles. Obviously, offensively, they've been on a pretty good track of what they want to do, what we might see defensively, if it's any different, I don't know. We can only prepare for what we know. And then you have to have principles that you rely on in case that's all different. So,
Coach, I saw just a little bit of a divine Zigbo in that game.
What? Yeah.
Zigbo, how has he progressed? And do you expect to get any of the guys back who didn't play last week?
Yeah, we were talking about that earlier, and I got sidetracked. I think that Divine should be good to go. He had a good last couple days of practice last week, so we took him on the trip. We weren't going to, but then he looked like he could go. And he really didn't play as much just because his preparation wasn't as thorough as the other guys or as he normally gets. But we did intend to use him if needed, and so we put him in there a little bit. But he should be good to go. Seathan won't be able to go this week, but he's getting closer and doing well. Jordan, I maybe would say doubtful, or maybe I'd raise that to questionable a little bit. He felt a lot better yesterday. He's been doing some running in that pool. I hope he can play, but we'll find out a lot more about it tomorrow.
Hey Mike, without guys like Steven and Jordan, how much more do you rely on Stanley Morgan, and what are his main attributes?
No, I love Stanley Morgan. I think he's one of the most tough-minded people that we have on the team, Steve. He is a reliable guy, and he was that coming in. That's why he played as a true freshman. We had so many injuries in camp, remember, a year ago, and so Stanley got a ton of work and just kind of showed everybody who he was. And I really respect that about him. He's a tough physically, tough mentally, good player, love him on your side. You love him on your team. He is, he's going to make tough plays. He's going to be that guy that you can rely on to do that.
Pure receiver attributes, in terms of pure receiver attributes, what makes him so good on third down?
Well, you know, I think that I'll start with the mental part. He's reliable, you know, so people like to throw him the – Tommy likes to throw him the ball because he'll make tough catches, right? But he's a nice-sized guy. He's strong. He's got strong hands, makes good catches in his hands. His target area is big because he can go get the ball like this, and he's real strong like that. So that's probably why.
Hey, Coach, during this winning streak, have you ever noticed when you're out and about, maybe getting more pats on the back than usual, do you notice kind of more of a fan buzz?
You know, I think that there is a great buzz. I've always been impressed with people's interest in the deal. But when you're winning games like this, there's probably a little different. But in Nebraska, it's pretty consistent with how people are, to me personally, on the street. How we've been treated since we moved here is really not a lot different. Everybody's excited about winning games, obviously, but I think there's a consistency to people out there, so it's not really out of the box right now.
Back to Purdue, I'm sure people talk about football being a humbling game, right?
Yeah.
So how humbling of a moment was that coming off that field? And I remember that following Monday, you would come in here with a lot to say.
Yeah.
You had thought a lot about what you wanted to say, really, to fans and even the reporters. As you sort of remember that weekend, what do you take from that? The fact that you guys rallied so well from it. What do you recall about your thought process and why it was important?
Well, you know, I think Sam, there's a lot of stuff there, and it's a good question. But I think that, you know, one of the most important things to always try to be is realistic. You know, and you know, when you're not doing well. You know, your job is to basically give people some idea of how this might try to get better, because everybody wants it to be better, especially your team. And so most of my thoughts as I go into talking to you or anybody else is really talking to our team. You know, I've got to give a message to you guys and to the fans and all that. But when I talk like this, I'm always thinking about the team is hearing what I'm saying about this stuff. So I think that's always a focal point, because in the end, our job is to help these guys grow, have a program that you can all be proud of, and then win games. So that the most of my messages are, even though I'm talking to you, I'm directing at our own team and coaching staff.
Hey, Coach. Eric
had a concussion, and we hope that through the protocol that he's ready and able to play this week. We missed him on our special teams last week.
All right.
Okay, thank you all. Good to see you.